Hello, my name is Jason Noble. I'm a postdoctoral fellow at Université de Montréal. Many thanks to the organizers of this EARCOM forum for the opportunity to speak and to the ACTOR project for supporting this work. My title is Challenges and Advantages of Homogeneous Orchestration, and the main example I'll be discussing is my piece Fantaisie Harmonique for Guitar Double Orchestra. And what you see on this cover slide is an image from the premiere at the 21st Century Guitar Conference in Ottawa in 2019. So, what do we mean by homogeneous orchestration and why is it interesting? Stephen McAdams defines orchestration as the choice, combination, or juxtaposition of sounds to achieve a musical end. In theory, this definition is extremely broad, encompassing all possible sounds. But in practice, the term has usually been applied to the sounds of musical instruments, especially the instruments of the symphony orchestra. The default assumption is that combinations or juxtapositions occur at the level of instrument, so that we might say, for instance, that cellos and horns blend well together. But when we say things like this, we rest on mental archetypes for these instruments, perhaps referring to their most characteristic registers, dynamic ranges, and playing techniques. In fact, each instrument constitutes what McAdams calls a constrained universe of timbres. And for any given timbre of the cello, only some of the timbres of the horn will blend, while many others will produce different orchestrational effects. Therefore, orchestration is better conceptualized in terms of sound qualities than source identification. The practical consequences of this distinction are very clear in orchestration for ensembles of homogeneous instrumentation, where it's all the same kind of instrument instead of mixtures of different instruments. Homogeneous ensembles may seem more niche than mixed ensembles, but they make up an important part of the musical landscape. Clarinet choirs, trombone ensembles, guitar orchestras, and so forth satisfy McAdams' definition equally well as the symphony orchestra, but rule out any conception of orchestration based on instrumental differences. Homogeneous ensembles therefore present interesting challenges to composers and orchestrators who may be used to thinking of orchestration in heterogeneous ensembles, but who still want to have a rich, broad, and diverse palette of orchestral effects at their disposal in homogeneous settings. In this presentation, I want to demonstrate that indeed they do have such a palette, so long as they conceive of orchestration in terms of sound qualities, which might include attack transients, spectral content, pitch structures, dynamic contours, and real or virtual spatial locations. These can be deployed to produce the same categories listed in the orchestral effects taxonomy produced by McAdams and colleagues, to which we now turn. The orchestral effects taxonomy lists in a hierarchical way a lot of the different categories of effects that can be produced by combining instrumental timbres. This taxonomy has been presented in many formats. If you want to learn more about it, please visit the module on the timbre and orchestration resource of the ACTOR project website, or see the chapter by McAdams and Goodchild in the Oxford Handbook of Timbre. This diagram shows the three hierarchical levels of simultaneity, which describes how concurrent timbres combine or separate in the formation of musical events. Sequentiality, which describes how musical events combine or separate in the formation of musical streams or layers. And segmentation, which describes how streams or layers combine or separate in the formation of larger units like phrases or sections. There are too many categories in this taxonomy to discuss them all, but let's take a moment to consider the middle layer of sequentiality to get a flavor of the logic at play. This level deals with the grouping of musical events over time. The integration branch deals with how sequences of events form streams or surface textures. If the sequence consists of one event at a time, the result is a stream, which is a unitary musical pattern, the classical example being a melody. Timbre is a powerful factor in stream formation. If the timbre remains consistent over the full duration of the stream, then it is stable, and if the timbre changes over the course of the stream, then it is transforming. Another kind of integration involves more than one event at a time, produced by two or more sound sources, organized such that it's difficult to segregate them into different streams. Instead, they loosely group into a texture. used here to mean the consistency of a surface. Factors such as attack quality, spectral content, registral overlap, dynamic parity, and so on are essential in determining whether or not sounds that happen at the same time will integrate into a texture or will split off into different streams. As with streams, textures may be either stable or transforming. It seems intuitive that where integration is the goal, either into a stream or into a surface texture, homogeneous ensembles have an advantage, for similar instruments are naturally well suited to produce timbres that will group in perception. On the other side of the sequential level are orchestral effects based on segregation. In streaming, more than one stream unfolds simultaneously. Note that each one must be integrated within itself, but is segregated from other streams that happen at the same time. There can also be segregated textures with more complex layers consisting of more than one event at a time, such as surface textures or homogeneous chorales. Cases like that are called stratification. Like singular streams and surface textures, segregated streaming and stratification may be either stable or transforming. Since perceptual difference is essential for segregation, homogeneous ensembles have a disadvantage for these orchestral effects. Similar timbres will naturally tend to group together, so the sound qualities must be clearly differentiated if segregation is the goal. This can be achieved by registral separation, contrasting articulations or dynamics, modified timbres, and in many different ways, but the orchestrator must plan carefully to ensure that the differences will actually be great enough to create perceptual segregation. These categories are presented as distinct within the orchestral effects taxonomy, but of course in real music the situation is much more continuous and fluid. The composer may gradually move from one category to another, or may introduce competing cues that might suggest one category or the other depending on how the listener directs their attention. In short, once these categories are established, they may be used creatively and with varying degrees of clarity. Just as in tonal music, a composer may either firmly establish tonal centers or may vaguely and ambiguously imply them. We turn now to my piece Fantasy Harmonique, in which I tried to do just that, using perceptual effects creatively. I'd like to discuss some of the particular features of this composition and allow the taxonomic categories to present themselves in the background through that discussion. The piece is for guitar double orchestra, one orchestra of classical guitars and the other of electric guitars. Admittedly, there are significant timbral differences between the classical and electric guitar, so this ensemble is not technically entirely homogeneous, but nevertheless, it is an ensemble consisting exclusively of guitars. The recording I'm presenting today was made in studio multitrack by a single guitarist, Steve Cowan, who you see in this picture. He recorded all 12 parts using only one instrument for each orchestra to maximize timbral consistency. And we were very, very fortunate to have an amazing team of artists, recording engineers, and collaborators who made this ambitious project possible. We'll see some examples of their fantastic work, along with explanations of relevant aspects of the piece, beginning with its instrument-specific tuning system. So by instrument-specific, I mean that this tuning system is meant to work idiomatically for the guitar and is not necessarily transferable to other instruments. Now, it might be possible for other instruments to produce all of the same pitches, but the system is designed as a complex scordatura or alternate tuning system for the guitar and realizes the pitches with the open strings and natural harmonics available within that tuning system on guitars. Additionally, the timbre of the guitar's natural harmonics is at the heart of the composition, and so it would be very difficult to reorchestrate this piece for any other ensemble. The tuning system divides each orchestra into six groups, and for each group, tunes the six open strings of the guitar to two different major triads. For example, group 3 retunes the open strings from the standard E, A, D, G, B, E to E flat, A, C sharp, G, B flat, E, which works out to an E flat major triad and an A major triad. The third strings, G and C sharp, are just intoned to the roots by specifying which harmonics on the strings need to precisely align, and that results in some microtonal deviations for those strings. Each orchestra is treated similarly with two different triads, resulting in a global tuning system that covers all 12 major triads in root position and just intonation. An interesting result of this system is that no two groups have exactly the same tuning for any string. The total pitch collection within the system contains 30 pitches per group, 180 pitches altogether, and that collection is perhaps most foregrounded in an extended Hocketing section in which smooth microtonal melodic lines are divided between six guitars. We're now going to hear an excerpt which was taken in the studio during a mixing session. In the 3D audio recording, the guitars are virtually positioned to surround the listener, creating interesting ambiguity between the timbral homogeneity and smoothness of the melodic lines, which strongly suggest integration, and disjunct spatial positions of the sound source, which strongly suggest segregation. This brings me to the next point I'd like to discuss, spatialization as orchestration. For me, the idea here is that the distribution or movement of sound sources in space provides new grouping cues that influence the perception of orchestrational effects, in addition to adding a new layer of aesthetic interest to the composition. Spatial cues can interact with other perceptual cues, either reinforcing them or contradicting them in interesting ways. The opening section of Fantaisie Harmonique, inspired by Ligeti's Lontano, creates the illusion of a distant landscape that gradually subsumes the listener. But whereas Ligeti, writing for a large symphony orchestra, is dealing entirely with imaginary space, our 3D audio medium allows us to use a more literal sense of spatial positioning as well. The clips in this presentation are in binaural audio, so the spatialization effects can be heard if you're listening through headphones. The full recording is available in both stereo and binaural mixes at the Soundboard Scholar website, along with other support material for an article that Steve Cowan and I recently published in that journal. We will also be releasing a full 3D version of the piece soon in installations, concert performance, and online. So in the opening section, the two orchestras introduce the same pitch content at the same time, which provides a cue for integration, but several other cues suggest segregation. The niente attack of the electric guitars, achieved with a volume pedal, contrasts with the more clearly defined pluck attacks of the classical guitars. Also, the dynamic swell and shrink of the electric guitars are organized in a regular meter, while the classical guitars are integrated into a free-time aleatoric texture. There's thus an ambiguity in the orchestration, whether the listener perceives one integrated surface texture or two stratified layers will depend on their sensitivity to these competing cues. The segregation cues are enhanced by spatial design. The classical orchestra begins at a distant position in front of the listener and gradually splinters off and surrounds them, creating the illusion of drawing closer and immersing. At the same time, the electric guitar orchestra is reduced to a point source with all of the guitars appearing to occupy the same spatial location, beginning high above the listener and then gradually spiraling down towards them. Both orchestras thus follow an overall trajectory of drawing nearer to the listener, but they take different paths to get there. This is visible in a video of the spatialization automation, which we're going to see right now. Thank you. The final section of Fantaisie Harmonique presents a different kind of ambiguity, in which the two orchestras initially have similar aleatoric textures that will probably integrate into a single layer, but they gradually diverge to create segregation. The classical guitars gradually organize around a tactus. It's kind of like a random distribution of events that gradually coalesces around a bell curve that grows tighter and tighter, eventually arriving at a different orchestral effect called punctuation blend, in which approximately synchronous onsets cause sounds to group together. Throughout this section, the electric guitars remain rhythmically free. The muted but still pitched sounds in the classical guitars contrast with the ringing harmonics in the electric guitars, which progressively ascend in both pitch height and spatial position. Eventually, all these cues work together to make the segregation very clear, but at the point at which that occurs might vary from listener to listener. The example I will play features digital animation by German artist Kurt-Laurent Steinert that reflects the musical layers. In the examples discussed in this presentation, homogeneity of instrumentation created different advantages and challenges that I have tried to exploit creatively in the piece, allowing for a seamless stream integration in the Hocketing section that would be almost impossible to achieve in a heterogeneous ensemble, as well as effective textural integration within each orchestra and occasionally between them. In other cases where segregation was desired, the homogeneous ensemble required different strategies than a heterogeneous ensemble might, ruling out segregation based simply on instrumentation and requiring differences to be created through sound qualities, which might be enhanced by incorporating spatialization into the orchestrational design. Often, I found the potential for ambiguity to be tantalizing, allowing the music to dance on the threshold between integration and segregation in a way that would be more difficult to achieve in a heterogeneous ensemble. Homogeneous orchestration forces the composer to think about the qualities of the sound every step of the way, crafting sameness or difference carefully rather than assuming them as basic properties of instrumentation. It also unlocks and multiplies the timbral potential within a single kind of instrument, opening up possibilities that the composer might never have considered in a more standard ensemble. I hope to have made a case for the vast creative potential of homogeneous orchestration, grounded in the same perceptual principles that underlie heterogeneous orchestration, and demonstrated in my piece, Fantaisie Harmonique. Thank you very much for your time and attention.